people.
What is it? It's 12:04 there, right? I guess it's time for drinking.
Yeah, it's close enough.
It's close enough. Lunch break.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's 9 a.m. here, so unless I'm going to put whiskey in my coffee, I'll have to.
I might as well. You know. And here we are again with another episode of the Bourbon Pursuit Podcast. My name's Kenny. Today, we have Nino Marchetti. He is the editor-in-chief, the CEO, whatever, of thewhiskeywash.com. And we'll talk about more about the Whiskey Wash here in a second. Today, we're coming to you from my house. We're sitting here sipping on some of my bourbon. I got Ryan here with me. Yeah, my new house, so... No, it's so new that we're actually sitting in some chairs on a console table, staring at a TV-less wall and a messed-up couch and all kinds of things because everything's just still in chaos around here for me.
Yeah, our studio sucks, but no, we're making it happen. It's coming along. The house looks good, though. I'm liking what y'all have done here, so...
Well, maybe if we blow up big enough, we'll do like a whole Taylor Swift thing. You know how she invited right. like 10 of her biggest fans to her house to, you
Get
know.
A
like,
Cribs episode here.
Yeah, something like that.
For sure.
Yeah. And I figured, you know, while I had Ryan over here to record this, figured we pop open one of the newest bottles that was just released. So I have in my hands right here a bottle of Kentucky Owl, batch number 2. Bottle 881. And we've had some sips of it pretty good. And I think it's pretty good for what it is. You know, there's a lot of people that I would say give it a little bit of
a hard time.
I'd say a very hard time because, you know, who is this? You know, they're an NDP. I'd never heard them before. They don't have a brand. They don't have any kind of history. But, you know, even for a source bourbon that is going for a high price tag, even for this one bottle out the door here at a local liquor barn, it was $181 after tax. So was not cheap by any means, but I think it's not a bad one to add to the collection if you can spare a few dollars here and there.
Yeah, I think it's pretty good. One cool thing about it's kind of like Willett's, you know, they have those, you know, a lot of their stuff sourced that you get now, and they select very short, not very many barrels, I guess. So they're picking like the finest of the finest. So even though it's sourced, it's still like really good product. And so I'm really pleased with. I bought a bottle, I hadn't opened it yet, so I'm glad you let me try yours. So now I know to keep mine.
Yeah, but, it's always the science experiment. Like who can you try first before right. I figure it out? But it's really worth cracking that open, so I can't get rid of it.
We got some, you know, fall's coming, so we're just the releases are starting to hit here in Kentucky, and we got stuff coming out all the time, so we're excited about that. The Parkers, I think, hit today. I'm going to try to get that down to Bardstown.
Somebody's got to run out to Bardstown today and go stand in lines. And then I know Old Forester birthday bourbon hit as well, and some of the bigger liquor stores are maybe getting it tomorrow, maybe getting it next week. So who knows? So it's starting to get exciting back here in Kentucky for bourbon after a long summer's break. And
it's exciting until you show up in line and there's like 100 people in front of you. And you're yeah. like, what the hell?
Yeah, I mean, just to kind of talk about that, even this past weekend there was the Old Forester birthday release for one liquor store here in town, and they had 66 bottles. And they said it Saturday morning they were going to start releasing them at 9 a.m. I think at 7 a.m. they had close to 100 people already in line. So it just kind of goes to show you that the demand around here in Kentucky, especially in Louisville, is just astronomical. It's starting to kind of really show how hard it is to get something. I'm almost dreading what it's going to be like for the rest of the season.
Normally, you know, like with the antique collection stuff, you'd have to wait in line, but there might be like 15, 20 people. Now there's hundreds, and so it's just getting tougher and tougher. But it makes the chase more fun and rewarding, I guess, when you get a bottle. But
yeah.
Definitely exactly. Wish it was like the old days.
So with that, let's go ahead and start on with the show. So today we have Nino Marchetti. He is the, I don't know, you could say master editor-in-chief, the CEO, whatever, of thewhiskeywash.com. And we'll talk about more about the Whiskey Wash here in a second. So, Nino, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on today, guys. Appreciate it.
So let's talk a little bit about, just quickly kind of give us a quick overview of the Whiskey Wash, and then we'll kind of talk a little bit more about it.
Sure. So the Whiskey Wash is a news and information website on the whiskey lifestyle. And basically what we're doing is reporting on everything from new whiskey releases to interviews with folks in the whiskey space. And when I speak whiskey, I'm talking on a worldwide level, whether it's awesome Kentucky bourbon or scotch or some of the craft guys here in the U.S. We do reviews and write about accessory products, among other things.
Well, cool. So one of the things that we're proud to announce today is that you know, we've been talking to Nino here in the past couple of weeks, and we're actually going to start a partnership here kind of going forward and kind of see how it works out. So One of the things that you're going to start seeing a little bit differently on this show is that some of the episodes that we're going to be pushing out, you know, we're going to be able to put a quick little advert and blurb there for the Whiskey Wash and be able to help drive traffic to his site and vice versa. Start looking for some podcast episodes that start showing up on some articles over there. So we're definitely happy to begin this journey together and, you know, help build two successful brands out of it.
Seth, definitely the same here. You know, we have been looking to get into the podcast space for a bit, and what we figured would work best for us starting out would be partnering with an awesome podcast that was already established. And I've been listening to you guys for a bit through my iPhone when I'm driving to and from my office. I am streaming the podcast, and I've been really impressed by the interviews you guys have been doing and the fun and light attitude you've had with the folks you've been talking about and covering the bourbon story there in Kentucky. There's just so many tales to tell. And so I'm definitely looking forward to working with you guys and featuring your podcast on the Whiskey Wash and working together to promote the whiskey lifestyle.
Yeah, I mean, awesome.
Yeah, with that, I mean, we're lucky that we do live here in Kentucky, so we are at ground zero for bourbon, if you will. So, I mean, it would just make sense that that's the spirit that we try to promote as best we can because we're surrounded by it. But yeah, I mean, so who knows? Here in the future, we might get some Redbreast or whomever to kind of come on and talk to us. So we might expand out in the whiskey world if we run out of folks here talking about bourbon.
I can't imagine you're going to run out of people to talk about bourbon in Kentucky.
Yeah, it's not a short list by any means, is it?
Yeah, no. I imagine you could probably do a couple hundred podcasts and still be like, hey, there's some guy in X town that wants to talk about bourbon. Let's go interview him.
Right.
Yeah, for sure. So speaking of, you're talking about stories. So how, tell us your story. How did you like get involved in bourbon or whiskey? Like, what was your first experience with it?
So I've been a whiskey collector for a few years. I live in Portland, Oregon, and sort of the backstory there is that I've been drinking craft beer for quite a while. Portland's sort of the epicenter for craft beer in the U.S. We have
and hipsters.
Hipsters. Yeah. Oh, tell me about it.
But the thing I like about Oregon, though, at least one of the few times I've been to Portland, I mean, you can't swing a dead cat without hitting a brewery. I mean, there's one on every single block. And, you know, I love my porters and stouts. And the great thing about being there, they're always in stock. They're always in season. Versus when you come here in Louisville, if it's summertime, good luck trying to find a porter or a stout on draft anywhere.
You know, I think at the last count, we had something like, oh, here we go. There were, the last count, there were 61 breweries in Portland alone and an additional 30 in the outlying suburbs for a total of 91 breweries in the greater Portland area. So, and none of them seem to go out of business. Everybody loves their craft beer. So, you know, drinking that, started getting into barrel-aged beers, stuff that's been aged in bourbon barrels. And that kind of got me thinking, I wonder how the bourbon would taste against the beer. So I started tasting the two of them together and was like, oh, this is pretty good. So I started drinking
bourbon. Oh, yeah. Boilermakers.
Oh, God.
Oh, I remember those from college, man. That was not a fun time.
God. I started drinking bourbon away from the beer, and that was a couple years back, and started collecting a few bottles here and there and getting into other types of world whiskey, like a scotch or what have you, but bourbon sort of continues to be one of my main passions. And yeah, I've just got a big collection of Kentucky whiskey both here at home and also at a storage site. And
my Lord. So you're telling me you got an offsite bunker or something like that, padlocked?
Yeah,
up?
Well, I live in a small apartment, so the size of my whiskey collection doesn't allow fitting into the apartment at this time, so I kind of keep it stored off-site. I'm a bit of a whiskey collector in addition to a writer, so I guess you could call me a whiskey geek overall.
Hashtag whiskey problems.
Right? Yeah. Pretty much. Not complaining. You know, I'm just looking at my whiskey collection right now from across the room, and I've got the I.W. Harper 15, the Blade & Bow 22. I've got a Woodford Reserve sitting over there, a few other bottlings. So, you know, and it varies night to night what I like drinking. Sometimes it's bourbon, sometimes it's scotch, but mostly bourbon. And enjoy.
You must like twigs.
Stuff coming out like of scotch. Kentucky.
You've said that 10 times on these shows. Yeah. Ryan's not the biggest fan of scotch all the time. So.
I know.
It depends on the mood, you know. It really just depends on the mood.
Well, it sounds like we could have a Hoarders episode whiskey edition with you or something like that at some point.
No comment.
Yeah. So I guess let's talk a little bit more about the site. So talk about some of the articles that you guys have that you kind of feature, because, you know, I visit it quite regularly, and it seems like you always have a ton of new content coming out every single day. It's not like one of those regular blogging sites out there where it's one person doing it and there's a new article by him or her, you know, every other week or something like that. But I mean, it's a constant rotating of information. So kind of give us some information about, you know, what you're doing.
So the focus of the Whiskey Wash is basically to sort of look at the way whiskey magazines have been publishing and bring that into the online space, again, covering things on more of a global level. So, you know, part of our coverage on a daily basis is bourbon. It's sometimes other whiskeys of the world, it's accessories. And there's just so much information out there to report on that we have plenty of stories to be able to potentially write about. So the site's been around for a little over a year as a full-time venture. I started it as a hobby blog just to see, you know, if there was interest in folks reading about whiskey content on a larger scale like that. And definitely there has been. And at this point, you know, I've got quite a large group of folks that have come on board to contribute writing with us. I have a couple of people there out of Kentucky that are contributing stories. I have a large group of folks here in Portland that are doing whiskey reviews for the site, and with that we're reviewing everything from bourbon to craft, etc. I've got a couple other folks that are covering whiskey in other parts of the country, sort of writing about what's in their backyard. So I mean, there's just a lot of whiskey stories out there to tell tales about.
Let's talk about some of the writers, because I know one we've actually had on the show before.
Yes, Maggie Kimbrell is a we call her our bourbon country editor at large. And basically, I had come across her over social media. She's a very active Twitter person, as we all know, especially talking about things with bourbon and some of the writing she'd already done. So we started talking offline and chatted with her, and we decided to bring her on to be sort of our first Kentucky-focused writer. And she's been writing with us now for, I think, about 2 months, maybe 3 months. And she's been contributing some great stories that have really resounded well with our readers. One story she had done recently, which talked about high-proof bourbon, was one of the most popular stories on the site for a while. She's interviewed some of the whiskey legends like Jim Rutledge. She just did a piece that's trending right now about the Old Taylor Distillery and sort of the rebirth that's going on there. So she's definitely got a lot of things that she's got stories to be able to tell. And then joining her on the Kentucky side is Steve Coombs. He's another local writer there. He's focusing a lot on lifestyle writing, doing whiskey reviews and some other types of pieces. And then his first piece that he had published with us recently was something pairing bourbon and country ham.
Well, that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean,
it's two good things.
I've heard a saying before that says, always buy your bourbon from Kentucky and always buy your hams from Virginia. So how well did that go well with the article?
It went well. People responded to it great. And, you know, the pictures, I'm just looking at the article right now, definitely make you hungry and wanting for bourbon at the same time. It's, you know, the thing about bourbon that he particularly points out in his piece, and then I have another writer who pairs food and whiskey all the time, is that it is quite possible to pair whiskey and food and get good flavor profiles out of both.
So have you guys done a whiskey, maybe the Pop-Tarts edition? To kind of figure kind of what's the...
Not yet, but I appreciate the story idea, and I will get someone on that one.
Someone tells me brown cinnamon's going to be near the top of that one.
Probably, I would imagine, yes.
So, I mean, you talked about Maggie's had a pretty popular article. I mean, are there any other... what are some of the other more popular articles that you constantly see more hits of people coming back to the site to read about?
I've been working with a search engine called Wine Searcher, and we've been promoting a list of their most trending and most expensive bourbons and whiskeys. And so two of the most popular articles on the site on a regular basis are 50 of the most expensive whiskeys in the world, hint, it is mostly Scotch, and 20 of the most expensive bourbons in the good old USA. those tend to be ones that trend most constant on the site. I think people are curious to know, you know, which bourbon in particular is being the most expensive out there. And obviously we know the answer to that one without even having to give the formal name of it. So,
right.
Yeah. So those kind of buying articles are popular. Another thing that's popular on the site right now, we just put up something the other day about the Buffalo Trace Antique Collection 2015, What to Know, and folks have been coming through and reading that a lot. And then Steve did a review for us the other day of the Elmer T. Lee bourbon. Well, that's been getting pretty good response as well. So, you know, as far as bourbon articles in particular go, people like to read a lot about reviews, and they like to read a lot about lifestyle pieces, sort of, you know, what are things I can do there in Kentucky? Or, you know, what can I pair bourbon with, what have you. So, and in fact, bourbon in general is our most popular whiskey category amongst the different ones we have. In large part, that reflects the fact that we're an American-based website, and most of our traffic comes from the Eastern Seaboard. So a lot of folks are wanting to know about, you know, what's going on there in Kentucky.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that because, I mean, I know Scotch, even Scotch trading, as you kind of talked about earlier, it's still a pretty big thing. So, I mean, do you kind of see you guys almost shifting to be, I know you want to stay, have a playing field that's pretty level amongst all the different kinds of spirits, but I mean, do you kind of see more of an influx of saying like, okay, we see more people are, reading about bourbon right now. Do we need to start, you know, cranking out more stories about that? Or is there, an inkling to kind of say like, well, maybe we can drive up some traffic for the Scotch drinkers out there?
When we write articles, a lot of it's dependent upon the information that we have available to us to write stories on, because obviously we're not just going to write stuff out of thin air and make up things. But you know, the thing with being an American-based website here in the U.S., a lot of the information we have more readily available to us is about bourbon in American whiskey, including rye. You know, a lot of the Scotch releases, obviously, are starting over in Europe, and we just don't have as much access to all the information. And sometimes even when we do, we'll pass on a particular story because given our more American-focused readership and we know the fact that that particular Scotch will probably never come here to the U.S., we probably will pass on writing about it unless it's a particular one that stands out for some reason. Like there was one the other day we wrote about. It is a 75-year-old Scotch that I believe there are just 100 bottles being made available of, and the price point was something like, I think, $35,000 or something like that.
Yeah, it's like couch cushion money.
It's
yeah.
An expensive
yeah,
piss. It was
Morton and McFowell Mortlock 75-year-old whiskey. And actually, that was a very popular article on our site for a bit, I think just because people were like amazed at the price point and the fact that it's presented in a hand-blown decanter. Yeah, the price point was around $30,000.
That's a BuzzFeed title right there. I mean, I'm sure that would attract a lot of people. I mean, I don't know. I find it hard to the stomach to spend $35,000 on a whiskey or a Scotch. But at the same time, you know, it's always funny because when we talk to a lot of people, and the same story comes up over and over and over when you talk to these distillers, and they say, the prime age for a good bourbon is anywhere between 8 to 12 years. Mm-hmm. Anything after that, it loses characters and all that sort of stuff. So when I think like, oh, it's been sitting, you know, they made it and then they put it into a bourbon barrel and it's been sitting there for 75 years. It's like, what possible kind of combinations of something could it actually have? And not only that is, you know, even with the story about this year's Buffalo Trace Antique Collection release of George T. Stagg losing 80 to 84% of its yield to evaporation, like something that sits there for 75 years. I mean, what's the evaporation?
Well, it's not as hot as there as it is here.
Yeah, I would think so. But
well, you know, they only ended up with, like I said, I think about 100 bottles, and that was from one single cask. So even given the cooler evaporation rate there, you're looking at still a significant loss of whiskey, right? I mean, basically, they put that one particular cask with fresh new make spirit in it, I believe, back in 1939.
Yeah,
and then basically the one family nurtured that particular cask for several generations before they cracked it open, I believe, earlier this year. But yeah, I mean, with something that old, obviously your rate of evaporation, even in the colder Scottish environment, is going to be pretty high. But then again, you know, $30,000 a bottle, I think they'll be okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hell, I would say
probably one bottle recoups their cost.
that's easily probably enough of having it sit somewhere in grandpa's house or his attic, just sitting there waiting to be opened or whatever. But if I was even thinking like 75 years, like, oh, hell, why not just wait another 25 and have a 100-year-old one?
Yeah.
No, I suppose putting it another way, you know, if we think the average bottle of Pappy Van Winkle is, you know, about 1,500 average, that's like, you know, 20 bottles of 23-year-old Pappy, right? Mm-hmm. So there you go.
there's my justification, right?
Yeah, there you go. So how are you going to spend your $30,000, right?
Yeah, right. I'm sure my wife would not appreciate that one.
you're pissed about $60 bottles, not much less $30,000.
If I came home with a $30,000 bottle of whiskey, I would be later curl up with it sleeping outside. So
yeah, something like that. So let's talk a little bit more about the site. You know, some of the other articles that kind of gain a lot of attraction and popularity, you know, is one of the other things you kind of mentioned about was reviews. Mm-hmm. So in regards to reviews, you said Sean did a few of them. So where do the these kind of people come, like their walks of life, like what makes them a
review-worthy
person? Yeah, review-worthy person that somebody's going to be like, yeah, I'm going to trust this person's knowledge.
Palate.
Yeah.
Sure. So a gentleman like Steve Coombs there in Kentucky, or some of the other folks that I end up having doing reviews for me, you know, they come from different walks of life. When I look at someone to review whiskey for the site, I don't necessarily look at their hardcore whiskey writing credentials and say, okay, you've been writing for XYZ publications and that makes you a qualified whiskey reviewer. I'm looking for someone who has a good sense of their tasting palate, knows how to write, and is passionate about whiskey. The reviews we have, I try to think of them more as sort of the common man reviews. It's like, okay, you know, if I sat down with Karen Moonen, who's a writer for our site, who does whiskey reviews, if I sat down with her at a bar and I looked at her and said, tell me what you think of the whiskey, she would talk to me in a way that I understand versus sort of these very elaborate kind of, you know, tasting notes that are spun sometimes by some review systems where you're like, I'll never get that out of there. How'd you get marshmallow Pop-Tart or something like
that? And fresh cut grass and tires, right? Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, I want people who, you know, if a very established whiskey reviewer came along and said, yeah, I want to write for you, et cetera, I'd sure that'd be great. But when I'm looking for folks that are writing reviews for us, I'm looking for folks that are passionate about whiskey, who drink whiskey themselves, who can write, and then, you know, we can kind of work on building their experience from there.
Yeah, I mean, I've always kind of looked at it, at least, you know, I don't do reviews because I guess my imagination's not there enough to sit there and smell something and taste something and then be like, oh yeah, I guess I do like get a sense of licorice or oak or honey or vanilla or caramel. When I first taste it, I'm like, yeah, that tastes like bourbon. Mm-hmm. It's just a little bit different than this one over here.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's, but no, it's always good to kind of get perspectives from people that actually know what they're doing, that can then influence the market to go either buy a bottle or not buy a bottle, sure, or anything like that. But even with that, even if somebody's doing a review on Elmer T. Lee, I don't think that's going to stop anybody from going out and buying a bottle because it's one of the best bargain bourbons out there if you can find it. And it's always a staple to even have on your shelf.
Yeah. And one thing I like about reviews too is like you said, we're not very creative. We're like, oh, it tastes like bourbon. But when I do read a review and they say that they notice this, I'll kind of see myself, yeah, you're right. You do kind of notice that. So it kind of makes you look for it and appreciate it even more.
Agreed. You know, one of our reviewers, Tish, she is also a chef. So she has a lot of pairing knowledge. So the things I like with the reviews we do is, you know, I'll give my reviewers a lot of leeway to sort of write in their own voice. They sort of all follow a certain format of nose, palate, finish, and a score. But so like Tish, for example, she'll often, you know, say, here's what I think of the whiskey, and here's some food I think pairs well with it. So some of our readers have responded really well to the fact that, okay, she just reviewed, you know, a bourbon, and this bourbon goes well as a, you know, with, like, chicken or something like that. So
a Chipotle burrito with steak or guacamole or something, right?
There you go. You know, we actually are currently reviewing a chili whiskey here out of Oregon. So I'm waiting for the review back from my reviewer. It's a Chipotle whiskey from a young distillery that's also a well-established brewery. So I'll be curious to see what their thoughts are on that particular one.
Yeah, it's interesting because even out there in Portland, it's surprising enough that there are, I mean, there are whiskey distilleries all around the U.S. And then also some, you know, you can be a bourbon and not be from Kentucky. But it's as much as it's to our chagrin, right? That right. we don't want to say it, but you know, it's true. It's true. Sure. By law, you can, but not to be Kentucky straight. For sure.
And you will be surprised, and maybe you've had this experience yourself with your podcast, but the number of folks that we have to get in discussions with in our comments on specific articles or on our social media about the fact that bourbon does not come from just Kentucky. Granted, I think it's like 95% of the bourbon comes from your guys' great state, you know, but there are some great craft bourbons out there as well. But it's interesting because a lot of folks are like, bourbon only comes from Kentucky. And then you'll be like, well, no, you know, bourbon does come from California or, you know, Idaho or places like that. And then we'll get a follow-up comment that's like, well, only great bourbon comes from Kentucky. So I'm like, okay, well.
And that's true. That no, point. I'm just kidding.
Maybe you got that point out.
So. No, I mean, it's definitely true that not all bourbon does come from Kentucky, but 95% of the world's supply does, but with good reason. I mean, we did have a little bit of a head start on everybody else in the industry. So we've got, you know, there's actually, if you go, there's a store here on Market Street. I can't remember the name of it, but if you go in, they've got t-shirts and it says there are more barrels of bourbon aging in Kentucky than there are people. And it's one of the small little known facts about Kentucky.
Right. And the Distillers Association there in Kentucky is really good about putting out factoids on bourbon, you know, with that being one of the ones that they always emphasize. We did a thing on the fact that it's Bourbon Heritage Month there in Kentucky right now. And that was a pretty popular article, you know, and in that piece, they were talking about how, you know, bourbon is like a $3 million economic engine for your state. And there are more than 5.3 million bourbon barrels resting Kentucky warehouses for the first time since 1975. And that you had close to 628,000 visitors there in your state last year, visiting the distilleries along the Bourbon Trail. So, you know, there's definitely bourbon is made in many other places in the U.S., there's no doubt. But the heart of bourbon is easily there in Kentucky. And I think most people who drink bourbon recognize that. You know, I certainly, when I came to visit Kentucky earlier this year for the Bourbon Affair, you know, you're like, okay, I'm immersed in the bourbon culture here. And I think that's part of what makes the difference. You know, I lived in California for a long time, so I used to go up to the Napa Valley for wine. And when you're up there, you're like, oh, I'm in the wine country because everything around you is wine. When you're there in Kentucky, everything around you is bourbon, whether it's the rolling hills or the, you know, the springs that you guys have for the limestone filtering or the horses. You're like, yes, okay, I'm definitely on my way to Woodford Reserve. I'm definitely visiting the Wild Turkey Distillery. It's just a whole nother level of experience.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm glad you've been able to see some of the great things out of our state and be able to visit, because it's definitely one of the things I know of a lot of our listeners have talked about. Even somebody that wrote a review on the last one, they said because of this podcast, they've actually came and did a tour of some of the distilleries and stuff like that, because they started to appreciate more of the heritage and the history that's actually behind it all.
Yeah, sure. It's nice to hang our hat on some. Most people outside of Kentucky think we're just a bunch of redneck and hicks. Well, so
fried chicken, right?
Right, and fried chicken. Nice. So it's like, you know, it definitely gives us something to be proud about, and the horses and so forth too. But
sure.
You know, we talked about your collections earlier, so I'll pose a question to you. So your apartment's on fire, and you've got one bottle to grab. What's that bottle? And let's put a picture that everything that's in your outside bunker that's padlocked is all inside your apartment. So what's the one that you grab?
Oh my God. Can they take like 15 different takes on this so I could just give you a different one to choose from? You know, I have to say probably my Blade and Bow 22 year.
Oh, that's right, surprising. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I know that one hasn't gotten the best reviews from some of the writers out there, but I'm just really enjoying the flavor profile of that. And I am a fan of bottle design. That's kind of a sucker for that. And mm-hmm. I just think it's a beautiful bottle design, but I just think it's a good taste in whiskey. So I would probably grab that and run if I had to grab one particular bottle.
And it won the best neat bourbon, didn't it? In the San Francisco competition.
I believe it did. I think Fred Minnick had written about that a while ago, and I think he was surprised, among others, at that. You know, because you talked earlier about that whole sort of like, what is that window for that perfect bourbon, right? And obviously the Blade and Bow 22 year is well outside of that, but for whatever particular reason, this one stands out from some of the other older bourbons. It doesn't taste quite as wooded, I think, as some of the other ones I've had in that age range.
Well, I'll wait for Ryan to go out and buy a bottle, and I'll take a sip of his now.
Nice.
Well, Nino, thank you again for joining us on the show today. It was a pleasure talking to you. So we'll have to have you come back again soon.
Thanks for having me on, guys.
Great. So as we announced earlier, we're going to have a partnership, so you'll hear some adverts and some blurbs coming in, so some shows that are coming up. But if you could, you know, always write reviews on iTunes. We love seeing the feedback. Also, you can follow us on Instagram and Twitter. Our handle is at Bourbon Pursuit. There's also, you got our Facebook page. You can like us there as well if you want to kind of get some of the updates that we put on Instagram and Twitter into your newsfeed, as well as all the latest podcast release will be in there as well.
Yeah, thanks again, Nino. Appreciate your time. And just want to encourage our listeners to go to the Whiskey Wash. It is a really good source for all information on bourbon and whiskeys in general. So with reviews, everything. I've been really impressed with the site since we've hooked up with Nino. So definitely y'all need to check that out. And we appreciate y'all listening, and we'll see you next time.